Immutable. It's one of those coding terms that can be really daunting the first time you hear it. So in this video, I'm going to break down immutability visually, explain what it is and why you would use it. The word immutable has two parts, the im meaning not and mutable. Mutable sounds a bit like mutate. You might think of genetic mutation, but what it really means is just to change. When it comes to computing, some value being mutable means it can change. A counter, for example, changes its value. But why would we ever want something that doesn't change? Imagine I'm drafting a novel. I pull out a page that I'm not happy with and make some edits. That's a mutable operation. Okay, but now my editor tells me that they liked the previous version better. It'd be good if the old copy was still around. So the next time I make an edit, instead of writing directly on the original, I make a copy and edit that. Now I have both the old and new copies. That's an immutable operation. But why would we want to do this in software? It can help us avoid a lot of pitfalls and bugs when it comes to the handling of data. Let's say I have a mutable function that transforms this frog in some way. The frog goes in, gets transformed, and comes out again. But what would happen if we send the transformed frog in again? We might get a totally different result. So let's reset our frog and use an immutable function instead. This time, our original frog returns unharmed, but we also get a transformed frog out the other end. If we want to run it again, we can, because our original frog wasn't affected. We could also chain multiple functions together that each make different transformations. At each point, our intermediate result is preserved and not affected. These are called pure functions. They have no side effects, always return the same result, and this makes it really easy to test them in isolation. Another benefit of immutable data is time travel. Just like before, if we keep old copies of our book drafts around, we can go back and revisit an old copy at any time. But this is also useful for checking the validity of operations. Here we have a graph, and we want to make sure that there are no infinite loops or cycles in it. When a new connection is added, we see that the operation has introduced an infinite cycle. We could show an error to the user, but we also now need to undo that operation. And that's a very error-prone process. What if our undo code doesn't exactly reverse the operation? By using an immutable data structure, we don't need to worry. We try the operation by just making a copy. And when we see that there's a problem, just throw the new one away. And on the other hand, if the operation is valid, we can instead throw the old copy away. And finally, one of the greatest benefits of immutability. Sometimes in software, we have some process that can only go so fast. One way we can speed it up is to do it in parallel. For many, but not all tasks, more processes means faster results. But parallel computation of shared data can be incredibly challenging and error-prone. To demonstrate this, we'll go back to our counter. But we need to make a distinction between the data stored in memory and the processor. Here we have only one processor, or thread, which reads, increments, and then writes the value back to memory. What if we introduce a second processor? Again, we read, increment, write from the first processor, and then the same with the second. But we actually got lucky here. We have two independent processors, and they just happen to process these instructions in order. But there's no guarantee that those operations will happen in that order. Let's see what happens if we simply reorder the operations so that both processors read at the same time. Now both processors read 0, the first increments and writes. The second increments, and can you spot the problem? We wanted to increment the value in memory twice, but got a completely unexpected result simply because of the order in which the operation happened. This is called a race condition. And it's happened because we have shared mutable state. So how can we solve this? This time we'll read just as before, but when we write the incremented value back to memory, we'll write it to a new location, an immutable operation. The other processor will do the same to another new location. Then once all of the increment operations are done, we'll introduce a new operation that runs on just one processor. We'll call it sum. That will take all the newly written values and add them up, writing the result to yet another new location in memory. And finally, we'll clean up the old bits of memory that aren't needed. Most modern high-level languages are going to do this for you. Okay, so it might seem a little wasteful creating all these copies all the time, only to clean them up. Isn't that a lot of additional work? Isn't it a waste photocopying our book each time we make an edit? Well, yes, but immutable data structures have a special trick up their sleeve. With our book, we don't actually need to copy the pages that haven't changed. Instead, we can copy and change only the pages that have changed and keep a list of references to the pages in the old copy. This way, we can even reorder the pages without copying the content of them. These are called persistent data structures, and you'll find them in many languages supporting immutability. Now, not all languages have the same level of support for immutable data. For example, JavaScript is typically not immutable by default, but it is very possible to write in an immutable way. There are various libraries that will help you do this. You just have to be particularly careful not to mutate a piece of mutable data. On the other hand, a language like Haskell goes to the extreme and attempts to make everything immutable and pure, encouraging you to use a special approach to isolate and contain any mutable data. My personal favorite language, F#, takes a very pragmatic approach. Immutability by default, but it's not hard to reach for mutable data when you need it. Whether you choose to work with data immutably or mutably depends on your circumstance. When data integrity is important, like in business apps or a typical CRUD app, immutability can be incredibly helpful for validation, time travel, auditing, and parallel processing. But in demanding processor-intensive situations like simulations, games, artificial intelligence, you might just be better off sticking with mutable data. As always, use your best judgment for the situation because every problem is unique. There's no reason you can't mix and match the approaches where appropriate, as long as it's clear to your peers or your future self what data is and isn't immutable. So that's the video. I hope it's been helpful to you. I'm hoping to cover a few more concepts like this in future, so I'd love to hear from you if there's anything in particular you'd like to see.